Ladies and gentlemen, our host for tonight is heard every weekday on 1300 public television and radio stations worldwide. She is the first journalist to win the Right Livelihood Award and has won two different awards named after I.F. Stone. Please welcome Amy Goodman.
Deeply moving this last few days have been.
And the music has been pretty good too.
Not bad, but I'm not singing. But I think what's so critical is that we consecrate this space as a sanctuary of dissent. That's what you have shown us is sacred. And how important dissent is in saving this country, and how important it has been in shaping this country. You know, just a few weeks ago, I was at the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor. Tom Hayden was there too. It was the 50th anniversary of the first anti-Vietnam War teach-in, and he was there 50 years ago. But that example of education that sparked a movement all over this country, not only then, but right through till today. And I think that's the also original model of what independent media is, a space where people can talk together, can learn. And we need to support that kind of media, be a part of, build that kind of media. It's not an alternative voice to the mainstream, because I think you all very much represent mainstream America. I think those who are concerned about war and peace, those who are concerned about the growing inequality in this country, thousands yesterday, today, the day before, have been marching in Baltimore. Those who are concerned about climate change, the fate of the planet, are not a fringe minority, not even a silent majority. But the silenced majority, silenced by the corporate media, which is why we have to take it back. The media is the way we learn about wars abroad. Unless someone is directly involved or has family in another country, we learn through the media, and it must be through something other than a corporate lens or a microphone brought to you by Boeing or McDonnell Douglas. Yours are the independent voices that I think across the political spectrum are deeply believed in today. You know, just a few weeks before the 50th anniversary of the first anti-Vietnam War teach-in at Ann Arbor, I was down in Selma for the 50th anniversary of the Selma to Montgomery March. Now, Selma, the number of people who turned out for that, not 10,000, not 20,000, not 50,000, not 70,000, it was between 80 and 100,000 people this year. And it was not just a commemoration of the incredibly brave souls led by John Lewis and others who marched over the Edmund Pettus Bridge. And you know this year when 100,000 people marched over it, that Edmund Pettus, that former U.S. Senator, Confederate General, Grand Dragon of the Ku Klux Klan, was deeply concerned in his grave. 100,000 people this year. Mainly young people from all over, not just the country, but the world. It wasn't just a commemoration. And I feel the same way about what's happened over the last 24 hours here. It wasn't just a commemoration. It was a coalescing of movements. And think back 50 years ago, the day after Selma, what was the front page of the New York Times? Yes, hundreds of people marched in Selma and were beaten back by the Alabama state troopers, And another headline, U.S. sends troops into Vietnam. These movements against police brutality, for voting representation, against war, are intimately linked. As you meet here today in Baltimore, the number of people who've been speaking out, and before that in Ferguson, and before that in Staten Island, the Black Lives Matter movement and May Day, that joining with the immigrants' rights movement, climate change, that goes across the political spectrum. That is the hope of the future. As we flew from Ferguson, bringing out the voices of people there, not only dealing with yet another killing of a young black man, but also with the police response afterwards, the militarization of the police departments of this country, it's presented as a kind of conservationist act, recycling, Pentagon in recycling mode. They want to use their weapons from Iraq and Afghanistan and recycle them here at home. But that's what we saw on full display. We went from Ferguson to Staten Island, where thousands marched to honor the life of Eric Garner, who died after he was put in a police chokehold that's illegal according to the police department of New York. And as he went down, it wasn't just one officer, it was a group of officers who would not help him, and a young, brave man who opened his cell phone and started recording. That's why we know exactly what happened to Eric Garner. He gasped 11 times, "I can't breathe." Police afterwards said the reason they knew, they said that because he could say, "I can't breathe," they knew he could. They not only didn't help Eric Garner as he lay on the ground, they prevented the bystanders who were saying, "If you won't help, let us." The only person arrested or indicted in that whole situation was not any of the officers involved, but the young man who took the videotape. And in the last arrest of him, he was arrested, his mother was arrested, another day his wife was arrested. They talked about the nonstop harassment. He said, the police said, "You videoed us, we videoed you." But I think about a young girl, and the people who marched in that march were not even just 20 years old, 15 years old. There were 10-year-olds with crayon drawings honoring Eric Garner. I went up to a 13-year-old girl who was determined, and she was just looking ahead, and she was marching, and she was from Staten Island. And I said to her, "Well, what are you hoping to accomplish here?" And she said, "I just want to live until I'm 18. That cannot be the American dream. And I think you have shown us the hope. You have shown us that the struggle is long, that you have to be there for the long haul, and that all of these movements are connected. To be out at the King Memorial, what a magnificent showing today. And for many of us, it was the first time there. You know, Julian Bond, in all his eloquence, mentioned that when Dr. King said, "The United States is the greatest purveyor of violence on earth," something you won't see at the King Memorial, one of the quotes was on the wall. "I oppose the war in Vietnam because I love America. As I speak out against it, not in anger, but with anxiety and sorrow in my heart, and above all, with a passionate desire to see our beloved country stand as a moral example to the world. What you do here reverberates throughout the world. It's so important that the history you are retelling here is the history that people in this country, especially young people, and people around the world hear. It's not an alternative history of Vietnam. This is the people's history of the United States, and we must ensure that it be told. I'm really looking forward to tonight, to hearing the marvelous cultural expressions of movements from 50 years ago right through to today. And always remember how important it is to include the media in every aspect of what you do. I see the media as a huge kitchen table that stretches across the globe, that we all sit around and debate and discuss the most important issues of the day: war and peace, life and death, and anything less than that is a disservice to the service men and women of this country, like Wayne Smith, who spoke just this morning. They can't have these debates on military bases. They rely on us in civilian society to have the discussions that lead to the decisions about whether they live or die, whether they're sent to kill or be killed. Anything less than that is a disservice to a democratic society. Democracy Now!